everyone, welcome to Control System Lectures. In the last lecture, we had discussed about the characteristics and types of nonlinearities. In this lecture, we'll be discussing about some commonly occurring physical nonlinearities, and after that, we'll deal with the different methods available for the analysis of nonlinear systems. So, let's start our lecture. Some common physical nonlinearities. The first point is saturation or limiter. Here, initially, the output increases with increase in input, and beyond a particular value of input, the output remains constant or increases at a very small rate. If we draw the saturation characteristics, it will look something like this. Initially, the output increases with the input, and at some point, the output remains almost constant. Similarly, in the other direction also. This is the characteristics for a limiter. An example is an op-amp amplifier, where the output initially increases linearly with the input and then saturates at the supply voltages, that is either at plus VCC or minus VCC. Now, the next physical nonlinearity is dead zone or threshold. There are many devices where the output will be zero for small values of input. The output will be available only when the input has increased beyond a particular threshold value. If we look at the characteristics of a dead zone, it will look something like this. Initially, the output will be zero for small values of input and then it increases linearly. Similarly, in the other direction also. Diodes are an example for this type of nonlinearities. For example, in the case of silicon diode, if the applied voltage across the diode is less than 0.7 volt, then the output is zero because the diode is in off condition. Beyond that, the diode is in on condition. Now, another example of a nonlinear element is relays. Relays are electromagnetic switches operated by a relatively small electric current that can turn on or turn off a much larger electric current. The relays can be classified into four based on the nature and approximation used in the process. The first one is ideal relay. Here, the output switches between the positive and negative maximum values depending on whether the input is positive or negative. Drawing the characteristics of an ideal relay, we will get for positive values of input, the output is positive, so this is plus M. And for negative values of input, the output is minus M. Now, coming to the next type of relay, relay with dead zone. In this case, the output switches only after the input has increased beyond a threshold value. Drawing the characteristics, the output will be zero until the threshold value, let's say the threshold value is A, is reached, and after that, it switches to the positive M value. And similarly, in the negative case, the output will be zero until it reaches the threshold value of minus A, and after that, the output is minus M. So, this is relay with dead zone, and this is ideal relay. Coming to the next relay, that is relay with hysteresis. Here, since there is hysteresis, the output is tracing one curve for the increasing input and another curve for the decreasing input. If we draw the characteristics, the output will be capital M for the increasing values of input. Let's say this is M. And also note that the path traced by the curve is this. Now, if we decrease the input, the output will follow the curve such a way that the output will be present until some negative value of the input due to hysteresis. So, the curve traced is something like this. And then it becomes zero. If we further decrease the input, then the output will be negative M. Let's say this value is negative M. So, this is the curve traced. Now, if we need to increase the input, then the output will be minus M until some value, let's say H by 2. So, this is minus H by 2. And after that, if we further increase the input, then the output will be plus M. So, the curve traced is something like this. Okay. So, this is the case of relay with hysteresis. Now, coming to the next category, that is relay with dead zone and hysteresis. This is a relay which exhibits a dead zone and hysteresis together. So if you draw the characteristics, initially there is a dead zone, and once the threshold value is reached, the output switches to plus M. So this is the path traced. Now if we decrease the input, the output will remain as plus M for a value less than the value of threshold A because of hysteresis. Okay, now in similar fashion, if we trace the curve to the negative axis, negative input axis, the curve will be something like this, and on further increase of the input, the curve traces back in this fashion. This is relay with dead zone and hysteresis. Coming to the next nonlinear element, that is a spring. The input output characteristics of spring can be different depending on the different types of spring. The first type of spring is linear spring. Here, if the elastic limit of the spring has not been exceeded, the elongation of the spring will be taken as directly proportional to the force applied to the spring. If you write the relation between force applied and the elongation of a linear spring, it will be something like this. F of t equal to k x of t, where k is the spring constant. So, if you draw the characteristics of a linear spring, it will be a straight line passing through the origin. So, this is linear spring. Okay, the next type of spring is soft spring. Here, once the elastic limit is exceeded, the incremental force required to produce an additional incremental deformation decreases as the spring deformation increases. So, let's say this is the elastic limit, some value h. After this point, the graph deviates something like this. So, this is the case of soft spring. And the equation of the soft spring is given by f of t equal to k1 x of t minus k2 x cube of t. Okay. Now, coming to the case of hard spring, once the elastic limit is exceeded, the incremental force required to produce additional incremental deformation increases as the spring is deformed. The equation of a hard spring is given by f of t equal to k3 x of t plus k4 x cube of t. Now, in the graph, once the elastic limit is reached, the graph deviates something like this. So, this is the case of hard spring. Similarly, in the negative direction, suppose this is the elastic limit h, then the graph deviates like this for hard spring and deviates like this for soft spring. Another example of physical nonlinearity is backlash in gears. To explain this, let's take a simplified model of a pair of gears. Let this be the driving gear and this is the driven gear. That is, this gear drives this gear. Okay. And let the direction of rotation be clockwise. Now, if we take a single pair of gear teeth, we can see that there is a small gap between the teeth pairs. Let this be h by 2 and let this be also h by 2. And you can note that this is the driving gear and this is the driven gear. So, if the driving gear starts rotating in this direction, you can see that the driven gear remains stationary until the driving gear travels through a distance of h by 2 and touches the driven gear. So, if you draw the characteristics, for a distance of h by 2, the output y is 0. After that, the output increases linearly with the input. Now, if we reverse the direction of rotation, for a distance of h, the output remains constant. I think you can all guess why it's so. So, this distance is h. And further decrease in the input results in the output to move in such a way. And similarly, if we increase the input again, for a distance of h, the output remains constant and then it starts increasing. So, this distance is also h. So this is the characteristics for backlash in case. Okay. So we have discussed some most common types of physical linearities. If we look into nature, we will find many more examples. Obviously, we can't discuss all of them here due to time limitations. So I leave it to you to find them out yourselves. Now, the next topic we have to discuss is the different methods of analysis of nonlinear systems. As we have discussed already, nonlinear systems are difficult to analyze and arriving at general conclusions are tedious. Several techniques are developed to suit different types of analysis, where each method has its own advantages and disadvantages. Therefore, it is necessary to analyze the same system using more than one technique to draw conclusion. One thing to note is that even these techniques doesn't always give global solutions, but only solutions under specified conditions. Now, the most common technique used for analysis is linearization technique. Linearization of a nonlinear phenomenon near an operating point and studying the behavior of the system using the linearest model is a commonly used technique for analysis of nonlinear systems. The validity of this analysis depends on how well the linearized model describes the actual nonlinear system. We will study the linearization technique in detail in a later lecture. The next method used for nonlinear analysis is the phase plane analysis. This method is applicable to second order linear or nonlinear systems for the study of nature of phase trajectories near the equilibrium points. Although extension of this method to higher order systems is theoretically possible, it is difficult to observe the trajectories in higher dimensional state space. The next method is describing function. It can be used for certain class of nonlinear systems with low pass characteristics, where it can be assumed that the harmonics present in the output of the nonlinear elements in the system gets attenuated significantly so that the fundamental component alone is needed to be considered. This results in a linearization by which the nonlinear element is replaced by an equivalent variable gain dependent on the amplitude and frequency of the input sinusoid. The accuracy of this method is better for higher order systems as they have better low pass characteristics. The next method for analysis is Lyapunov's method of stability. Lyapunov's method for stability was developed by Russian mathematician Alexander Lyapunov. The advantage of this method is that it allows us to conclude about the stability of system without solving the system equations. Now, some other methods used to determine stability are purpose criterion and circle criterion. However, we won't be studying these two methods in this course. We'll be studying the other four methods in a detailed manner in the coming lectures. That concludes this lecture, and if you have any doubts, please ask them in the comment sections. If you understood this lecture, please like the video and also subscribe to the channel. Thank you and have a nice day.